I love the periodic table. No, really, it gives me so much information about the elements, how they're both different and alike, what they're made of, and their mass. Once you get to know the various parts of the periodic table, I bet you'll love it too. Okay, so maybe you won't love it as much as I do, but it will definitely be a useful tool as you learn chemistry. And speaking of learning chemistry, what do you know about elements? Did you know that all of these items are different elements that can be found on the periodic table? Chemists separate elements into two major groups based on their chemical and physical properties. These groups are metals and nonmetals. That's a quick start. Now let's join our group of students as they explore the trends of the periodic table. They'll be using periodic tables and cards that you can find in our Chemistry Matters toolkit. The cards contain information about the chemical and physical properties of various elements, but not all of the information we know about these elements. The cards have been created with several unknowns, which makes them an excellent tool for recognizing various characteristics of the elements and understanding why the periodic table is organized the way it is. You'll see what I mean when you watch our students perform this exercise, and that'll help you when you do the same. So let's get to it.
Look at your periodic tables. The periodic table's laid out in columns up and down and rows side to side. Look at the far left column and notice that each column is numbered 1 through 18. Now start at the top left and label each row 1 through 7. To become more familiar with the periodic table, you'll become Dmitri Mendeleev, the father of the periodic table and one of my personal heroes. I love Mendeleev because his discovery in 1869 had such a huge impact on the world of chemistry.
Isn't he the guy who grew all the pea plants?
No, you're thinking of Gregor Mendel. He studied the variation in pea plants and is known as the father of modern genetics. Mendeleev studied the different characteristics of the elements that were known in his time. On these cards, you'll find information about the physical and chemical properties of many elements. Your task is to group these elements in some way and use the resulting information to identify some unknowns. The unknown elements can be found in groups or columns 1, 2, 11, 13, 14, 17, and 18. Work together because you'll have lots of information to consider. Go ahead and pour them out and look at your cards. Looking at the cards, how can you organize all of this information?
We could group them by a property, like a physical state.
But most of them are solids. Physical state won't separate them enough.
What if we laid them all out, like a periodic table?
Let's try that.
Sounds like you have a plan. This activity is challenging and can be very frustrating. You'll have lots of information to consider. I'll let you get started and check back in with you soon. Okay, let's see where you are now. Has anyone identified an unknown?
We've got unknowns 2 and 4. 2 is fluorine and 4 is krypton.
Why did you start with those unknowns?
These unknowns are gases. All the other unknowns and most of the knowns are solids, so we thought it'd be easier to start there.
Okay, so how did you decide on fluorine and krypton?
We looked at the properties on the different gas cards and put the unknown where it fit best.
Unknown number 2 is a pale yellow gas and has a melting point of negative 219.6 degrees Celsius.
The next element, chlorine, is a greenish-yellow gas and has a melting point of negative 101 degrees Celsius. As you keep going down the column, the melting point increases.
The densities increase as you move down the columns, too.
Does that mean you all agree that unknown number 2 is fluorine? What about unknown number 4?
We got fluorine, too, but we haven't gotten to unknown number 4. We decided to do them all in order.
We think unknown number 1 is either silicon or germanium because it has properties of carbon, tin, and lead, but we aren't sure which.
We think unknown number 3 is rubidium because its color, density, and reactivity to water fits in with all the other alkali metals.
Great work. I really like that you guys had multiple reasons for each identification that you made. Use this information as you keep working.
Wait a second, you're not going to tell us if we're right?
No, I'm not. Your group needs to keep working together, using the evidence to identify all of the unknowns. You can do it.
Our teacher wasn't kidding. This can be challenging, but I'll figure it out. The important thing to take away from this is that the periodic table organizes the different elements based on properties, and these properties relate to the structure of the different atoms themselves. You can also use these properties to predict element behavior. Dmitri Mendeleev did that when he organized his periodic table. He listed out properties of elements that scientists didn't even know existed, which is pretty amazing when you think about it. So let's get back to our classroom to learn a little more.
Now that you have an idea of the property of elements and how they're represented on the periodic table, we're going to put this information to use. Let's turn to the periodic table and identify some of these characteristics. You should have already numbered the rows, also known as periods, and the columns, also known as groups, on your periodic table. Now find boron. It's represented by the letter B. Does your periodic table have a stair line that steps down from boron and continues until polonium, which is PO? If it doesn't, draw one now using this periodic table as your guide. The elements to the right side of the stairs are known as the non-metals. All the elements to the left side of the stairs are metals. And the elements that touch the stairs are known as metalloids. Let's start with the metals. What are some of their properties?
They're shiny.
Okay, what's another word we can use for shiny?
They have luster.
Right, luster, good. What else?
They're malleable and conductive.
Please explain what you mean.
Well, malleable means that it can be shaped, and conductive means that electricity or heat will flow through it.
Good. You might be thinking of silver, gold, or even titanium and copper as examples of metals. All of these metals are solids, they're shiny, they conduct electricity, and they can be shaped into different forms, like statues or jewelry. These are known as transition metals. Find column 3 on your periodic table. Start with column 3 and count 10 columns over to column 12. These 10 columns make up the transition metals. Lightly color each of these columns in one single color. Okay, look at the bottom of your periodic table. Do you see those two rows that look like they were forgotten? These are called the lanthanide and actinide series because they start with lanthanum and actinium. Lightly color each row in another different color. Most metals conduct electricity well. Think about your element cards. What other elements from the activity were good conductors besides the transition metals?
Sodium, but is that a metal?
How about calcium? That's found in your bones, so it can't be a metal.
You might be surprised to learn that both sodium and calcium are metals. Sodium's in the first column. And this column or family is called the alkali metals. Chemists call the group or column a family because they have similar properties. Although hydrogen is in this column, it's not an alkali metal. Calcium's in the second column, which is known as the alkali earth metals. Do you remember some of the other properties of these groups from the Mendeleev activity?
They're not shiny like the other metals. They're soft.
Good. So these metals aren't as shiny as the transition metals, and they're much softer. We don't make jewelry or statues out of this kind of metal. Go ahead and color the alkali metals one color, but don't color hydrogen, and the alkaline earth metals another color. Hydrogen is placed in the first column because its electron is arranged similarly to the alkali metals, but its other properties are more like nonmetals. Remember, nonmetals are on the right side of the stair step line. Color hydrogen a color different from the alkali metals to help remember these different properties.
You might have been as surprised as our students were to learn that not all metals are the kind we naturally think of in our everyday lives. In fact, many of these metals, such as sodium and calcium, are found in our bodies and even in the foods we eat. In addition to all these metals, we know that there's another large group of elements on the periodic table we've yet to explore. So let's check back in with our students and see what they're learning about nonmetals.
Two special groups of nonmetals are the halogens and the noble gases. Hydrogen has properties similar to the halogens, which are column 17. These nonmetals are very reactive. Column 18, the noble gases, they're not reactive at all. Pick new colors and color column 17 and 18 now. Look at the stair line we talked about earlier. Do you see the elements whose edges make up the stair line? These elements are known as metalloids because they have properties of both metals and nonmetals. Silicon is a well-known example because of its use in microchips for computers. It's the properties of elements like silicon that make objects in our everyday life possible. Could you imagine a life without your cell phones or computers?
Oh, I'd rather not.
That's what we'd have if we didn't know the property of elements and how to use them to our advantage.
The activity our students just completed shows us how the properties of elements were used to arrange the periodic table and how the periodic table classifies elements into the major groups. Now let's look at the information on the periodic table relating to each specific element. Do you see that each element is in its own box? There's a lot of information in those boxes that will be important as we move throughout this and any other chemistry class. So it'll help you to understand a few of the items in these boxes, as well as some related terms, before going back to the classroom. For instance, each element has its own atomic number, which represents the number of protons in the nucleus of an atom. Each box on the periodic table also contains a number representing the element's average atomic mass, which is measured in atomic mass units, commonly referred to as AMU. Average atomic mass is a weighted average of all the isotopes of that element in the universe. And now is a good time to introduce the term isotope. An isotope is the same element with different numbers of neutrons. That's right, the number of neutrons present in atoms of a particular element can be different from atom to atom. And this leads to a lot of additional changes and characteristics we'll explore in later units. Getting back now to atomic mass units, you'll notice that most of these numbers have decimal values, and you may be wondering why. It's because not all atoms of a particular element are created equal. As an example, take boron. Let's pretend for a moment that there are only 5 boron atoms in the entire universe. All 5 of those boron atoms have 5 protons in their nuclei. That's what makes boron, boron. But let's say 4 of the 5 boron atoms have 6 neutrons in their nuclei. Those 4 atoms would have a mass of 11 AMUs each. But one of the 5 boron atoms still has 5 neutrons in its nucleus, which means that atom's mass is 10. So if we wanted to find the average atomic mass of boron, we would add 11 plus 11 plus 11 plus 11 plus 10, which equals 54. We would then divide 54 by 5, and we'd get 10.8. We could then say that boron's average atomic mass is 10.8. Now, most scientists would drop the average and just refer to boron by saying it has an atomic mass of 10.811 AMU, but it means the same thing. As I said, we'll look at more of these characteristics of atoms in future units. For now, we just want to get a firm understanding of the information conveyed in the periodic table. So let's get back to our classroom to see how our students are doing with that.
Okay, find hydrogen. Do you see the number 1? Now look at helium. It's number 2. Look at the same place in lithium's box. What is its number?
Lithium is 3.
Good. These numbers are known as the atomic numbers, which is the number of protons in the nucleus of the atom. Look at lithium. Do you see the number 6.9? There may be some other numbers after the 9, depending on the periodic table. Look at beryllium and find 9.0. Again, there might be extra numbers. These numbers are known as the average atomic mass and are measured in atomic mass units, or AMU. It's a weighted average of all the isotopes of that element in the universe. An isotope is the same element with different numbers of neutrons, which cause it to have different masses. Let's look back at the beryllium on your periodic table and figure out what other information can be found there. What do you see in beryllium's box?
The letters BE.
Right, BE is the element symbol. Chemists often use symbols in places of a name. Symbols are case sensitive, like passwords. Beryllium's symbol is not capital B, capital E. The E has to be lowercase. Find argon on your periodic table. What's its atomic number?
18.
18 is right. So what's the average atomic mass?
It's 39.9
AMU. Don't forget your units. To what group or family does argon belong?
Argon is on the far right, so it's a nonmetal.
Yes, argon's a nonmetal, but what family is that? Remember, we just color-coded it a few minutes ago.
Is it a noble gas?
Good, noble gas. Great job.
You've seen how much information is available to you just looking at the periodic table. And some periodic tables contain even more information. Use the key on your periodic table to help you understand any added information. You may not love the periodic table as much as I do yet, but you'll be using it a lot, so you'd better make friends with it at the very least, as we continue to explore the properties of atoms.